Yo, what's good? Welcome to another episode of Fun with Dumb. I am here joined by another group of friends that I've known for mad years, and it's amazing because every episode I feel like I get to catch up with old homies and shit. And this is another one of those situations. I'm joined here by rappers slash just all around musical experimenters, I feel like. That's what I could say. It's like, right. You know, there's certain cats who just rap and like that's what they do, but y'all really take it to another level. I get inspired when I see y'all perform and shit. We're here with Taran and Omari. What's good,
up,
y'all?
Man, what's
yeah,
up?
What's good?
Hey,
yeah,
gave you the little intro.
For real. Thank you for having us through. Experimental.
Yeah, man.
No, I feel that, man. I feel like over the years, you know, I've seen y'all do, you know, it's just spit from being in like living room of my crib just freestyling to like seeing your live show, and it's just some other shit, you know what I'm saying? So I'm a fan.
Yeah, man.
I'm a supporter.
Likewise. Yeah, us
for
too.
Sure.
That's what's up, man. So what's new? What is new? Is anything like going on right now, like different? Or, you know, I mean, obviously we all go through some different life
just
shit,
getting into hell of production. Just been producing a lot, making,
producing,
yeah, like yeah, making beats and stuff, losing my mind in Ableton and yeah, just making music and experimenting and kind of getting into different stuff.
Is it like for other people or for yourselves or what?
Everything, like for other people, for ourselves, yeah, like yeah, writing for people. And
nice.
Yeah, the last two projects we did, we produced, and just really just been getting into that. Like the most, our most recent album, Wet, The Wonderful Ego Trip, did that whole thing, 15, you know, 15 tracks, 14 tracks.
Yeah.
Yeah, just and then the album trying shit, that, you know,
yeah, just
trying new things.
Yeah,
that's tight, man. I feel like every time y'all work on songs, it's dope because y'all just really conducting different instrumentalists coming in and like getting piece from here, piece here, tweaking things here, and like you just don't kind of see that nowadays, really.
Yeah, know? Right.
Or yeah,
well, maybe.
I mean, not, yeah, the elite of yeah, musicians,
right, you know? Yeah,
but
the heads, no.
Yeah, exactly, yeah, the heads, you know, and that's. That's just a whole nother thing because I feel like cats be getting lazy with it, or I mean, it's just like people just don't want to go that extra mile.
Right,
right.
It's
right,
just I guess it just depends on your level of fascination. Like you right, know, when you're young, you're fascinated. Like when you first started getting into rap, you listen to every rap record that you could definitely probably get right, your hands on. You like scrutinized and studied, and you know, because you had the freedom to.
Right.
Like, you know, it wasn't necessarily to get super
straight
rich.
Up.
It was just because you was fascinated.
I was a techie before I started rapping.
Oh,
I used to go online and just
yeah,
battle people like with text raps.
Right.
You know,
no, I've been in that world. There was yeah, a lot
I
of.
I didn't even know how to write a beat properly.
Yeah, yeah. No, I feel that because that's like you're just writing out the text, right? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So there's no audio. There's you don't have to be in pocket.
Did just hit somebody up. You want to battle?
But did you ever
go
like
back
say
and forth
what
in the
beat? Like they should listen to it.
No, nah, because yeah,
like, do you put in parentheses? Listen to Mobb Deep Shook once.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That is hilarious. Like, you must read this text with this beat behind right, it. Like,
exactly, forget about Dre.
You must piece together this experience of you losing this battle.
That's crazy. Because, like, I'll tell you right now, that text seeing shit. There was a huge Asian community of like Asian rap community who was behind. Like,
for real,
they were really into that. That was a thing. You know
yeah,
what I'm saying?
That's tight.
It was fun. You know?
And I remember talking to Conceited, their battle rapper,
uh-huh,
he was a huge tech seer,
for
like
real?
In
for
that
real,
in that forum, like
damn,
he was a big dude in there, like people knew about him.
That's crazy. I feel like the name always sounds familiar, but like maybe,
yeah,
yeah,
yeah, he's like a battle rapper, but it's his style kind of makes sense. Like yeah, if you hear him and then
yeah,
think about him being a tech seer,
he's
like,
on Wildin' Out, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah,
yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
So I know him from that, and I know him from like other battles and stuff,
right,
maybe at like the
right,
pit or something.
And like when I heard that, I was like, okay, that shit kind of makes sense with his style,
right?
You know,
mm-hmm.
But yeah, I mean, I feel like, I mean, you even mentioning like tech seeing and shit, like were y'all just savvy to the internet, had like hella early and shit? Like,
I was really on like just download music. I never
right,
really knew a lot of the other kind of stuff, like, but it was really just on some like downloading shit.
Right, right.
You could always like Napster and LimeWire and Kazaa, like people be up in like overseas and they have something super rare that only got released out
yeah,
there, that, you know what I'm saying? So it was really just a lot of that and coming across hella instrumentals and
yeah,
you know,
that
coming
was,
across
yeah,
like Doom instrumentals and then finding out who MF Doom was. It was like,
nah,
oh,
for sure. That
yeah,
was my introduction to a lot of producers, I feel like.
Oh yeah, yeah, for
the,
sure.
The pirating world.
Uh-huh.
Cause like I got, you know, I remember just freestyling in my room and you type in like hip hop instrumentals and you get
yep,
like Doom, Pete Rock, you know, man. Dre.
What was the instrumental that every? What was so the instrumental that everybody had? You can't say Tribe by 12.
There was always like a handful of instrumentals that like everybody used to freestyle sure. to.
Everyone had the Big L.
Milk Bone.
Yeah, the one he went in on.
Samuel Jackson and a sample in the middle of it randomly. Mm-hmm. Randomly. Everyone had.
Oh, you talking about the Shaheen and Big L?
Yeah.
I remember one. There was that one like Pharrell and Snoop Dogg instrumental that came. It was like called Bomb or something like that. You know what I'm talking about?
That might be some. You might have had some like super leaked.
I feel like there was only a handful of joints that would pop out when you did a search back in the day.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because there was less of a catalog. Now it's like there's so many.
And the whack thing about it is like now you type in and try to find instrumentals and somebody, some producer like recreated it and uploaded it to YouTube.
Yeah.
It's like, but nah, they'll actually redo the whole beat.
Yeah.
Like, and then put it up as the official instrumental.
It's like they reworked the instrumental.
Wait a minute, this ain't the same snare.
Yeah.
Exactly.
I love the type beat. Genre now, exactly. You know what I mean?
I found out about that like because people will respond like with a comment.
Yeah.
Like somebody say something that's super super sad happened to them, and they'll be like, they'll post a beat and be like, whatever they went through, type beat.
That's oh my god, that's hilarious. Midlife crisis type beat. Yo, you know y'all have made it if you come across a Teron and Amari type beat.
Right.
That'd be fucking fire, dude.
I feel like the internet has no losses. It's always been hard
no losses.
For people to like do a tight beat and like it be like, oh yeah, that's it.
Yeah,
it's
exactly.
It's hard to like, you know what I'm saying? Like, cause
I mean, low key, tight beats, it's like scoring.
Right.
It's like I feel your moment right now.
And scoring is not easy, man. I remember, you know, Anderson like was scoring the whole audio for a web series we recorded called Run DMZ back in the day.
Oh yeah, I remember that.
And
he did
all the music like reactions and like run-in scenes.
Oh, yeah.
And I remember sitting and watching him do it like, damn, that shit was not easy, but it was tedious. Yeah, it was tedious and just capturing moods. Right. You know what I mean? It was not fucking easy. Like, I just remember the reaction between, like, what? It's crazy. How hot would you be if you came across a Teron and Amari type beat and it was hella whack?
It's definitely possible.
I'd be like, well, you know, at least they're thinking about us.
It's
exactly. You know what I'm saying? Might even rap to it.
It's like if you Googled your artist name and then, you know, on the bottom it says related artists, and then you just see the roster of artists that are affiliated with you. Like, what if y'all ain't feeling it?
You know what? Our Pandora station was super weird at one point.
Really?
Yeah, it was real weird.
You guys got the eclectic sound, so I'm curious, like, who would you guys put in with?
We didn't know. A lot of artists that I didn't really know.
Right.
A lot of that shit was like connected to us from like our previous stuff, not. Like people we had did songs with.
So, but I feel like even like it was like not even artists, like people that we did songs with, but more like sound that like our fans might have been listening to at the time.
Yeah,
or something.
Right.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Our Pandora station was super dusty at one point. It still might be. I don't know. Amari said he hit him up.
I get like the other artists who were just like, there's no relation in sound. It's just another Korean rapper. And it's just like, I'm like, son, there's no correlation here except we're just Korean. But yeah, it makes
sense.
They're
like, there's a correlation.
Exactly.
Yeah. Let's just like kind of take it back. I feel like just for cats who ain't familiar, like how'd you guys pretty much meet, you know, like as artists and friends?
On Yahoo.
Yeah, it goes
chat.
Back to the internet.
Oh, word.
Yeah, we met on Yahoo chat.
Damn, I didn't even know that.
Yahoo chat used to have chat rooms, like freestyle battle rooms. Everybody, well, if you were into that, you go in there, you had a little microphone, sit on a desk just like this one, a little small white one, and you could just talk to people. And it was like, it was new at the time. It was like,
y'all be freestyling?
Yeah, like you can walk, you can go in a room and like people, there's like a talk button that you can hit and whoever's in the room can talk. So right. like some people would just lock the whole room down for hours and just
there's a way to lock the button. Yeah. And someone lock the button so, down and they'll just be on there for hours just rapping.
And be like, yo, get the fuck off.
So it was like a code you could put in to boot people out of the room. Right. It was like all kinds of like.
But did y'all, okay, so like when you're freestyling and you know like the freestyle etiquette, like sometimes cats just don't have the etiquette of like falling back and letting another guy rap.
Oh,
like how was the etiquette in the chat room, though? You know what I'm saying?
Because that's what I'm saying. Some people would just hold it and rock.
Oh, that was that was the thing where they were just didn't have the etiquette.
Right. And some people would just rap it. Yeah. Rap.
And you just boot that motherfucker? Like,
he's like, there was this one dude in there. His name was like Lenny. It was like the most basic name, but he had like the coldest bars. And he would just hold the button and just talk shit about everyone and rap and like diss everybody.
Yo, that is the original. Like Fortnite rappers, like just the video game rappers now. Because you have a lot of video game rappers that just like go on the audio thing, you know, play video games
and rap about people?
Or they rap or they just play their songs. Because I heard like that's how like YB and Namir, like that kid got discovered
I heard
too.
Danny Brown be doing that shit too.
Right. He be playing like Persona 5 or something. Like, but I'm not even a video game head, just heard that's like the new shit. Like
that's crazy.
That's how a lot of people got discovered and shit. On Twitch, you guys are kind of the OGs of the Yahoo
like a lot
chat.
Of people. I met, you know who Mr. SOS is?
No.
He's from Florida. I think he did songs with Cunning Link.
Oh, where? Yeah, Cunning Link. Yeah.
Like, I met him like a long time ago, and he was like pressing play on like his songs, and then I started pressing play on my songs, and we were like some of the only people who actually play our songs.
That's it.
Like now, everybody pretty much makes songs, but like, then it was more like, oh, we was rapping because not a lot of people know how to use Cool Edit.
Oh, and, for
like,
sure.
SoundForge and all that kind of stuff.
You're just being from completely different cities as well is like amazing. Like, yo, I'm connecting with somebody I never met before.
That's
never
when
seen.
He moved out to LA because he started going to school up in the Bay, and then it was like, oh, somebody that I know that raps is on this side of the.
Right, West Coast.
Are you coming to LA? Man, let's get up. And then we just kept making music from then on.
Damn, that's crazy. Yeah. Straight through Yahoo chat.
Man. Yeah. Shout out to Yahoo.
Yeah, sometimes everything isn't a catfish nightmare. It could just be a collaboration and it could happen.
Straight up. It was all kind of, I had romances online and everything. Just be there talking to women all day and just like serious, like every day hitting, what's up, baby? How you doing?
Yeah, no, I mean, I had that with like people.
Never met these women ever in my life.
You see, I had that with people I knew, you know, like
I'd be spitting.
No. I'm saying not like, you know, on AIM just spitting my game to that goes to my school or something.
My confidence
is so much weaker in person, but on AIM, I'm just killing it.
Yo, remember away messages?
Messages? People would have the ill ones, the paragraphs and stuff. But
like, remember just putting the away message up, but you're not really away? You're just screening.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Damn, this is some throwback old head shit at this point.
Exactly.
That's how, so y'all met then, and then when you said you came to LA, and then that's how you guys linked up?
Yeah, well, first I moved to the Bay for school, and then from there, you know, started taking trips down.
What kind, where'd you go?
A school called Expression College for Digital Art. Oh, I think it's owned by SAE now.
Oh, okay.
Full Sale or not?
I think SAE.
So was this like you were an illustrator, or like what did you do? Like
Sound engineering.
Yeah. Oh, damn, that's tight. Mm-hmm. Shit. So, you, and then like... How long y'all been making music together? Because I've known you earlier on as a solo artist.
Yeah.
But then at this point now, I feel like, damn, y'all been rocking with each other for a minute.
Yeah.
Right.
Like, how long has that been?
Well, like, even when I was I was a solo artist. Like, I had a project called Handshakes and Pounds. But even then, we were making music. So it was like we always were making music, even when I was kind of solo. And then, like, when I did this project called Catch Up, we had... did a whole bunch of records that we were putting out because we used to have a blog called The Exactly. Like when the blog games kind of first started popping, like we wanted to be on the blogs, but we was like, okay, well, nobody's gonna put us up because, you know what I'm saying? This is like the era of like pirated music. So everybody's sharing like all of the shit that the labels is kind of sending out or whatever. And we're like, okay, we're gonna put together our own blog. So we had a blog called The Exactly, and like we Googled Zach Lee and found a picture of this white dude who did like insurance blog.
Yeah, that's great.
And we had the homie redraw him, and that was like the mascot for our
that's
site.
That's hard.
So like we wrote posts as if we were like 55-year-old white dudes.
Yo, I vaguely kind of just remember like y'all always posting some things like just random Tumblr-esque things. Yeah. And I remember just like, just being like a fan of that, like see, kind of like collecting images for like a mood board. Right. You know what I'm saying? Right. Like y'all always did that. Yeah. And I always like, it's dope because I was never kind of that dude, but I always would get inspired by just following different people who would curate that like kind of for me.
Yeah.
And I just vaguely kind of remember y'all always posting like Tumblr-esque images.
A lot of blogs pretty much back then was just like, I mean, shit, like now. They wouldn't really put up anything outside of music. So it'd just be like a song.
Right.
We put up a song, a food review.
Yeah, we'll put up.
So true.
You know what I'm saying? Movie review.
New technology coming out. Just dope shit.
Funny stuff. Right. Like, we put up all kinds of stuff. So it was like.
Tumblr was kind of like that.
And for sure.
I kind of missed that Tumblr world. Y'all were like heavy Tumblr.
I wasn't heavy in the Tumblr.
I was at one point.
You kind of were, I think. Or somebody, one of y'all, I would see some
Tumblr
shit.
Tumblr's dangerous though, man. There's a lot of booty up on there. You can get lost real easy.
Yeah, you can get lost in the booty for real.
Yo, I be seeing, you know what, one thing I hate is like porn Twitter accounts. Like just.
Oh, yeah, like, man, that shit's great. But girls be retweeting them shit.
I don't like that shit. Like, I don't need to be seeing some like hella sexual shit at like 11 in the morning. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm trying to run errands at the Whole Foods and getting me horny in the fucking frozen food. I don't like, like.
Especially, boobies.
And you can't even unfollow certain things because people retweet random shit. Yep. So
homies be retweeting stuff.
I don't get the dudes who retweet that shit.
Like your family members don't follow you. Like
it's
nothing,
not even. I mean, it's just like vulgar as fuck. You know what I'm saying? Like motherfuckers just like double penetration going on at like 10 in the morning. Yeah, like you don't need that.
I feel like there's a certain bit of anonymity back then that existed online that don't exist now, because now it's like you got Instagram, Twitter, like it's easy to find out who a motherfucker is like real fast,
right?
Whereas back then you could just kind of like say some shit or
There's a lot of people, there's like a darker world of people not showing who they are too though, like you don't they don't have anybody.
That's that augmented reality.
Have you ever heard of this documentary called Tickled?
Oh my God, that shit is disturbing as fuck.
Super disturbing. I was like, whoa.
It's you, why don't you explain?
I kind of know, but basically it's like.
It's about the underworld of tickling.
Yeah, like, there's like something called, there's like tickle fetish or some shit like that. And like, there's like this, I can't explain. It's like some old dude.
Yeah, they're trying to find out like who's behind this like
underworld,
but it gets crazy.
But like basically, you know, people get blackmailed into like keep doing it because it's like, if you don't, we're gonna put out these pictures of you
being tickled.
Yeah, of like, you know what I'm saying? By like,
But they're finding out all this. They think it's like this whole elaborate fucking collective of people, like, but they find out it's just like this one dude like doing everything.
Shit, it might be a collective of people. They probably just wanted to nicely, neatly wrap it up and say it was just the one dude.
It is crazy though when you see.
Must be like a professional at tickling.
Nah, it's not. He's not the tickling. He pays.
He's like,
he pays
your body.
There.
You know the evil dudes that go like this, like Mr. Burns?
He's just
tickling. He's just tickling himself like, excellent. This is how you tickle. Yeah. This nerve connects.
I can access.
Yeah, you go to his like lab and he just has a body anatomy like here and here is where you get the best tickle out of a person. that shit is disturbing, but
it is 4 o'clock. This is the prime time
to wrap it up like that is disturbing.
I don't know how we got the tickles, but that's so amazing. Cause
the dark underworld of like the internet, especially you know. Remember iMeme, or I think it was called iMeme.
What is that?
IMEEM. It was like another.
No, I don't remember that one.
iMeme was like SoundCloud before SoundCloud.
Yeah, it was like SoundCloud meets LimeWire.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Which is like,
I remember SoundClick.
SoundClick.
Yeah, SoundClick was like a OG.
I still got old songs up on SoundClick. That website ain't going nowhere.
It's still around?
Yeah, I swear.
Somebody's still renewing SoundClick.
If you had a SoundClick and you ain't, I swear, just type your shit up. That shit's still there.
SoundClick was like mainly, it was bigger for producers. That was kind of like an original SoundCloud, really.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
but there was, I mean, it's just like a lot of websites. These are like, I don't know if like, There's gonna be some people who know what's up with this shit, right. You know, like E-Bomb's world and shit.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Like these are the OG.
E-Bomb was
just
like
early,
world
early
star.
Internet.
E-Bomb was like world star before.
E-Bomb was pretty OG for like that genre of shit. Yeah, and they would have like even video games, like independently made Flash
video games.
I used
to
on
play those. Right. Them shit's tight. Yeah. Right.
Just mention old shit.
You know, internet shit.
Black Planet. Oh, Asian Avenue.
I signed up on Black.
That's what it was called. Asian Avenue.
I probably just filled y'all in some shit that y'all didn't know about. You know what I'm saying?
Yo, everybody look for Dumb's Asia. What is it? Asian Avenue. Asian Avenue.
So these are like, you know, before like Facebook and social media platforms that just had everybody. Like those like different ethnic you know, social media platforms.
Yeah.
Like Black Planet was one of them, and then Asian Avenue.
On Black Planet.
Yeah. The white web. No, I'm fucking with you.
Exactly.
I just made that. that's the white people dating site. No. But Black Planet Asian Avenue was kind of a little bit more like a dating thing, wasn't it?
Or, I don't know. I don't remember.
Were you on Black Planet?
No. I didn't do those things. It was really just like on some music shit. In the early internet days, it was really just all about finding, because it was like, underground music kind of started to become a little mainstream, and the internet existed. So I'm getting everything, downloading it. I was really downloading everything.
Audio
Stay up
Galaxy.
For hours. I have like gigs even back then.
That's the main thing. Like, I feel like, you know, we're a little bit older now compared to like a lot of kids like in the game now. But like, I feel like we've been able to kind of, you know, still get, you know, adapt to all the platforms going
right.
on. We're coming from a generation where we're passing out fucking physical flyers for shows.
True.
Yeah. You know, like one of my moves.
That shit's still effective though.
You think so? Physical flyers?
It might be. Well, has to be.
Posters are.
Yeah. I do like visual. Like if it's a dope design and you put up a poster or flyer, like sometimes like I want to take that poster. You're not going to put it, you know?
Yeah, true that.
But like, yeah, it's depends. I feel like I remember the transition from physical flyers to like posting bulletins on MySpace.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
And you have to have a code, like an HTML code to post that.
Yeah.
That's so crazy that.
Have you ever passed out flyers to your show?
Oh, 100% I've done that.
For real?
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever done that.
Oh,
that
really? Shit, yeah, I was.
That face-to-face shit is still, I think it'd always be.
You just post up and pass out flyers?
No. I wouldn't do that. But every time I would have a show, I would have a stack of flyers for my own show and pass it out to people that I know or whatever.
Okay.
I remember, you know, at one point in L.A., I would have shows like, I would have 3-4 shows a month and I would have flyers to all of them, like stacks of them. So I'd go in my backpack and pass out like 4 flyers to each person.
Damn.
But I would never do it on the street, like cold calling some random dude.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like I wasn't one of like the Venice heads, like passing out mixtapes and shit. But I was definitely passing out flyers to that. And when thinking back on it, I'm like crazy. Like I have a whole book over here, like a scrapbook where I saved almost every one of my early flyers for my first show to the first 5 years.
I see that?
I don't think I have it here.
I got that shit too, but
you have your the first flyer from the show, that first show you
my
ever
first
did.
Show I have
yeah
it.
Damn.
I have the flyer from my first show too.
Damn,
that's crazy.
Well, this is my first but it's my first one out here.
My first,
like your first
boombox
show,
yeah,
like
my
legit
first show,
right.
Yeah, yeah. Wait, what was it?
Boombox.
Boombox. Yeah, that's a classic. I had that show too. That was one of my first shows too, like with them.
Shouts out to Angle One.
Yeah, yeah. I
feel like I had a show. My first show might have been at Faye Dodo or Low End Theory, the old one.
Yeah, I've been
maybe Knitting Factory.
All the Chinky
too.
Eyed shows.
Yeah.
With,
yeah, yeah.
Thinking back, I'm like, yeah, they were really called Chinky Eyed.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
But no, I was definitely.
Were they Asian?
No, 501ers.
Right.
You know, yeah, no, they weren't Asian.
That's crazy.
I was the only Asian dude doing chinky eyed shows, you know? So I think they were like, oh, we're good, as long as we got Dumb on the roster. But yeah, no, I remember, I mean, I can't even hate. They gave me some of my first shows.
Yeah.
Right.
You know, like.
Shit,
us too. My first, like, LA Underground show was about 2004. But my first show was like 2002, and that was just some community shit.
Right.
But 2004 was like the first like LA underground show.
I felt like you rocked the blow before that though, right?
Yeah. Well, it was around the same time.
Oh, okay.
So I was doing it the same time, but I was doing Blowed, but like at Project Blowed, it was more like it was a different vibe, you know. Like I wasn't on a flyer. I'm signing up to perform.
Right.
You know,
yeah,
that was the first show I was on the flyer.
Yeah.
I was nervous as fuck too.
Wow. Yeah, 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 gotta be. Yeah.
When was you guys' first show? Like.
Our first,
I feel like Knitting Factory.
Or just Knitting Factory
together.
Knitting Factory.
I mean, separately and then together. Like when
Separately it was Knitting Factory for sure.
Separately, it might have been the Knitting
Factory. Oh, really? Both of y'all just performed separately at the Knitting Factory?
Well, nah, I got on stage with him. He had a show at Knitting Factory. I didn't know how to perform at all.
It might have been.
There's a picture somewhere I can find it, and then, you know, I'm holding a microphone, but the microphone is like this far away from my mouth.
Yeah.
But that's a big vein.
I feel like Tunji was rocking that day too. I feel like Tunji rocked too.
Yeah, for sure.
Tunji and what was his group? He had a
Inverse.
Yeah. Yo, my gosh, man! I was on a roster with Inverse for sure back in the day. I mean, Knitting Factory is an OG spot.
Yeah,
they don't exist no more, right?
No.
Or there's one in New York.
Yeah, yeah, but the one in LA has been gone for a minute. Right. Shout out to Tunji. Tunji is now like, what is he? He's like the head dude somewhere.
Head nigga of killing it.
Yeah, he's an artist who used to rap like coming up in the LA underground, but now he's like A&R a bunch of amazing artists. Yeah. I think he's like
shouts out to Tunji, man.
He's like a high position at like a major label somewhere. Yeah. He's always doing some shit.
Get your Googles.
Yo, that's the crazy thing is like there's a lot of artists too that kind of went like a different route than like making music. Yeah. It's still music related, but they become managers A&R.
Right.
You know?
But it's still like you can still tell though, because they like really love music.
And that's good. So like we need more of that. We need more music artists making that transition. No, the industry.
I feel like some of the dopest people who work in the industry used to make music.
For sure.
Right. I feel like that, I mean, it only makes sense that you have a background like listening to shit or making music.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Have an ear so you know kind of what needs to be done.
Right, right. Yeah. So at this point in your career, you guys made so much music and you guys are creative, so I could see you guys constantly making music from here on out. But do you guys ever think about like picking up like a super young artist and like cultivating him and shit?
Yeah, sure. It's just they're hard to find. They're not hard to find. It just takes patience and a lot of conversations and developing.
A lot of Yahoo chatting.
For real. It takes a minute to kind of like
Find somebody that trusts
you
and
that you can trust.
So you guys do always have an ear out for that.
Hell yeah.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Hell yeah.
And I mean, we'll, in the same way that we have an ear out for new music and new artists in general, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
Because it's always new flavors to be, you know, being inspired by and shit.
And then the first like thing you guys would do would like reach out and try to collaborate with them, or what would it be?
For me, it's just telling them, yo, your shit is tight, and just becoming fans of one another, and then kind of, yo, what you listening to? And then, you know, it's more like conversationally building and being like, eventually being like, yo, let's go. I'm not really the person of like, oh, yo, let's get up.
Right.
And then we haven't really talked and then be like, okay, let's go make some music, like immediately.
Right.
I mean, you know, if it's a session and that's like kind of what it is, if we're building and there's no real money involved, then it's like, yo, we gotta.
I think that's one of the biggest things. It's like, if you're a young artist coming up, like I wouldn't really look for a manager. I would try to look for a producer.
Like an OG
or someone, just a good producer that, you know, you're going to make sure you get some good production behind your raps vocals or whatever.
And you need shit to manage.
So you can have a
sound. In order to have a manager.
Yeah.
Otherwise.
That's the crazy thing now. Kids just want, like, they jump into finding a manager now. You know what I mean? Like, you have, back in the day, you kind of have more of, like, you participate in the culture a little more.
Right.
Yeah.
You go to an open mic.
There's a lot of shortcuts the internet allows you to take, you know? And I think people take for granted, you know, getting those steps in instead of skipping steps, you know, so you can know why you need a manager, not just because someone says you're supposed to have a manager, you know.
Right.
Know what a manager's job is, so when you get one, you could talk to them and dictate, you know. You can manage your manager.
Exactly.
You know, even your manager needs managing.
I've seen managers who can't manage their life and they're managing an artist, you know.
Shouts out to them, though.
Yeah. Shout out to all the managers out there, you know, just trying to manage themselves. Has your process, like when you started transitioning into more on the professional side, like, you know, what was the thing that made you feel like you needed a manager? I mean, is there anything in particular like that, you know, just if like for cats listening and like, when do you think they need a manager?
I think you need to manage, like Omari said, when you have something to manage. when you have enough to bring in and pay somebody 20%, that's when you need.
But is it
till then
songs like you should have enough songs, you should have enough music.
I think
like,
you should have a sound. Your friends should love your sound.
Right.
You can experiment and test your sound in front of other people and get a reaction. Like it's like, you know, that's what I think.
Yeah, yeah. Like, I mean, I guess it may depend on what type of artist you are. Like,
right.
You could be, you know, a pop artist and, you know, be put into like the machine and like just worked and like molded until you're ready, and you don't have to do all the work and like doing shows like we did and
right.
building your fan base and just be put out there. But if you not doing that and you're just, then you should like, you should have a little fan base before you have management.
Right.
Like. Yeah.
Now I feel like y'all have, you guys have built such a like a good indie kind of like a, from having a team to having like, you know, just your vision on like exactly what you want your art to be. You know, like mm-hmm. I feel like I only have a handful of friends who've really kind of built that vision. Right, you know what I mean? Right. The branding is like so important. You know
right.
what I'm saying?
Yeah, absolutely.
And like I remember just you guys having a collective and, you know, doing visuals to like graphics to the sound and shit. Yeah. Is that like what's that team building process kind of like? Is it just like
it's important? It's so
it's
important.
Very important.
Because like this, like art is a communal thing. It's, I mean, of course you can have your, you know, isolated, you know, brooding moments where nobody understands your music and, you know, you sit in the corner. Like one of the things I hate doing is like getting in the studio with somebody and then it's like, all right, now put on a beat. All right, now everybody write their verse. And then he writing his verse in his corner and I'm writing a verse in my corner. And then we come back and then make a fake hook and then kind of try to tie it together. I like to have kind of like, yo, so what are we writing about? What's the structure? How many bars?
Or even emailing like songs, right?
Right.
That's common now.
Right.
Right, right.
Yeah. But you guys don't like, you guys actually like building together.
Oh, yeah,
you
know? Hell yeah. Like being, sure. going from scratch is the most, is so important to me because it's like there's so many nuances that you can capture by like being in front of somebody's face. Like a joke might get cracked. But I feel like when it's like too serious and you don't want to share it, like if you don't want to share your premature ideas with the people that you're working with, then
I agree. I think you got you're going to get the best results from being in the same room together.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I mean, has that been difficult? Like with you guys being a duo and like just going through mad life shit and, you know, sometimes like y'all, it's hard to have multiple people that's in a, you know, group be in the same room together. Like how do you navigate that? Do you like kind of put it on hold until you guys, you know, get link up together or what? Like
I think well
I think is, I mean, communication.
Right.
Communication.
But also like we work solo. Like so I'll still make beats on, you know, and he'll still write and make beats.
And it's
and
later
then it's
on,
like and then it's like, yo, this is what I was working on. He'll bring it to me and it'll probably just be like a skeleton. But then I'll hear it and be like, so we like trade our ideas. Like I'll give him something that I was working on. He'll give me something he's working on. And then we just keep adding to it.
That's tight.
So it's like it becomes eventually both of our idea.
That's
right.
What's
up. Yeah. It's like you said, like being comfortable sharing your ideas early.
For real.
You know, because
that is
a lot
so
of times you write
though.
Something early and be like, I don't know. You know, it might be, you know.
Not saying you should have people ghostwrite for you or anything like that. But
I feel you though. Like
you do want somebody to let you know when your breath is stinking.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like if we go out in public and my breath smells like shit and you don't say anything, you're not the homie.
That's the thing about rap. Like I feel like a lot of kids don't realize that these great artists and stuff, you know, they exude confidence in their raps and stuff, but they're actually very open to listening to people's ideas in the room. Like I've been in the studio with major artists just kind of in the sideline, just watching them work, and they're taking like
humble as fuck
advice from other artists in there, like maybe this bar could be stronger or whatever.
Right.
They'll listen to it, and it's hard in rap because everyone's like on this like, oh, ghostwriting, blah blah blah, so they're all like careful about it, but not realizing people are like sharing ideas. It's a collaboration. I mean, it's that's like, how every other
you're
genre
missing
works.
Out, you're missing out on like
the creative experience.
The creative experience and the highest potential of a song. You know what I'm saying? All because your ego was in the way. When really
ego, that's
used,
a huge
you know,
thing. Yeah, like you guys, I'm with y'all like, and that's kind of been like a huge message, I feel like, overall with what you guys do. Yeah. Is like
just because that's what we deal with. You know what I'm saying? Right. I feel like that's what everybody deals with. But that's, you know, that's what we've been kind of dealing with and navigating through that from like the ups and the downs or
I feel like for the first time, you know, I mean, not for the first time, because there's been a lot of people who felt this way, like, but in hip hop, like everyone's kind of letting ego go and just toxic masculinity, and like there's like a big movement, you know, in the last couple of years. But I feel like y'all kind of had that from the jump. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like that message, I feel like. You know what I mean? Just like being completely.
Yeah, I think trying to be transparent.
Right.
So you
right.
know, just in case I am tripping and I am egotistical, you know that I'm trying
my best.
On it.
Yeah, yeah.
Like,
because,
you know, everybody's essentially trying
like we
to be
perfect.
Happy.
Yeah.
Everybody's waking up to try to be happy. You know what I'm saying?
For
like,
sure.
Nobody's waking up like, yo, I'm about to be a fucking dick right now. Everybody's trying to be happy. It just so happens their path to happiness kind of makes them look like a dick sometimes.
Right.
You know, but it doesn't mean that they're not trying to be happy, and happy is, you know.
Because that journey is just like, it's, you know, this artist's journey can be real selfish and self-absorbed. And when you do that, when you're like focused on the dream so much, you kind of forget about how you get to that dream in between, right?
Right.
Yeah, you forget about the simple things. You forget about the things that inspired you to do it in the beginning.
You got to, you know? I think it's important to be conscious of that. Sometimes you reach your dream and the next thing you know, you look at your feet and you're like, oh, damn, I stomped on all these people on the way.
Right. Like, that, you know? And, you know, I don't even hang out with some friends that I really enjoyed because I got so deep in the music that I forgot family members.
You know, it's a struggle. We were just talking
weddings,
about this. Yeah.
It's
a huge
thing. Birthdays, all kinds of
stuff. Yeah, and you know, we were just talking about this. You know, sometimes like that path to what you think is happiness is not really happiness sometimes.
Right.
You know,
right,
there's a difference between like reaching your goal and happiness.
Right.
You
exactly.
I try to make that like something that I'm trying to change too, just trying to make happiness a goal.
Right.
Yeah, as opposed to like two different things,
right,
you know?
Right.
That shit is tough, man.
Right.
Yeah, it is.
Absolutely.
And I feel like it's one of those things that you never stop working on.
Nah,
right.
Yeah, yeah.
So in some way, shape, or form, I feel like everybody's talking about their ego in music. You know what I'm saying? Like, maybe not necessarily so conceptually, but it's all like kind of navigating and trying to figure out how to be better people. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Whether they're super on some other shit. You know what I mean? Like, it's still all kind of part of this human narrative that we're all doing.
Yeah, yeah. It's crazy with hip. Like, you know, ego has been such a huge part of just hip-hop music in general.
Yeah, right. Hell yeah.
Like, would you say it has the most out of any other genre?
Well, I think the thing it's a misconception about hip hop. Like, there's ego, then there's competitiveness, and like
exactly.
a little bit of ego in that, but it's also I think it's more centered in confidence, and confidence isn't necessarily like
right
rooted
right
yeah.
It's confidence at the expense of it. You know what I'm saying? Like,
right.
in order for me to be tight, you got to be whack as fuck. Sometimes it is that.
Yeah.
But it is rooted in like a confidence.
Yeah, but if you watch a battle, like the dopest dudes. They still compliment each other during the battle while they're dissing each other. Like, yo,
right.
that was a dope ball. Yeah.
No,
I'd be
doing that. Like, yeah. I think that has a lot to do with just being, you know, good at your craft or being very secure with your confidence in the craft.
Right.
Because, like,
to where you can respect somebody
else.
Yeah,
if somebody
roasts
you.
Yeah, that battling shit.
Yeah.
Woo, that shit.
I mean, if somebody roasts you and you know that roast was good, like, you know how you just go
yeah,
in
yeah,
and you'll,
true,
like, dap
right,
them up.
Exactly.
That's
yeah.
what it is.
Yeah,
it's just
yeah.
a natural reaction. You're like,
yeah,
oh, I can't
yeah,
even
you
front.
Gotta,
like,
yeah,
that was that,
that
good.
Was, yeah.
But you know what that is? That's because y'all respect the art form of it.
Mm-hmm.
You know
right.
what I'm saying? It's not so emotional to where you still don't be like, artistically, that was incredible.
That,
right.
You know what I'm saying?
That,
it's
right,
like y'all view it with different lenses.
It's a craft, you know? I have a feeling with both. Sometimes I feel like maybe you should just get emotional too.
Yeah.
Right, you know what
right.
I mean?
Yeah, but then like that's how people get punched. I heard people, you know, I've seen like a couple
right.
videos where dudes get punched. And,
right.
Like,
that's just crazy. Like,
just look,
it's,
you know,
really
I,
pulling at their string. Like,
yeah.
it gets to them.
Man,
you know?
And like just getting clowned in front of people. And like you feel that, like I feel like
I've seen some bad ones.
When you're really
right.
good at it, you know how to take the punches.
Yeah, sometimes I feel like, damn, like how come I don't get emotional at all? Like I feel like I have issues of my own I gotta work out.
like
am I just a cold,
right.
numb motherfucker? Like,
right.
you know, I just feel like, damn, maybe I should feel something.
Holding it in. Let it out.
Let it out. Yeah.
It out.
Something I gotta work on, man. You know.
Yeah, battling culture. I wish I did. I'm not gonna say I wish. But that shit fascinates me.
Do you ever like just think of battle lines in your head?
Nah, I don't.
You do?
I
feel like you would.
I don't.
Yeah. We've had
I
a
don't.
Good amount of like freestyle sessions too.
Yeah.
And it's like, I feel like y'all would do fine in that
yeah.
shit, to be
yeah,
honest.
I mean,
yeah.
I used to battle coming
I get
up.
It before.
Oh, yeah,
yeah.
You were telling me that.
Yeah.
So you used to battle, like, was it just over beats? Did you do any of the acapella stuff too?
It was over beats. It was acapella, you know, you know, there was some texting, all that. Yeah, because that's how I got into it. And then eventually I was like, you know, I wanted to get more into songs and stuff.
Right, right. But,
I think that still got it in me.
Yeah. Is it just because like you just wanted to make music more, and that was just like more of a negative vibe or nah?
Well, battling wasn't what got me into rapping, and it's just
that's true.
You know, I just like, you know, being able to rap and being able to potentially make a dope song.
Right.
You know, more. I was attracted to that more so than battling. Battling was like just an aspect that I learned was something that you could get into.
Yeah.
You know,
I got battled a couple of times, but I hate losing. I am a sore loser.
So did you like some cats would just come up to you and just start like battling you? And then you would just like try to hold your own or whatever. Like,
nah, it usually be like in
would
a
you actually
cipher.
Enter a battle? Like,
yeah, like so, like it would be entering a battle or like you're in a cipher and then it might, you know,
right? It's always like that.
You know what I'm saying? But rarely cipher. It's usually like signing up to a battle.
Yeah,
and like that shit was always kind of like, nah.
Right. I always did like the cipher battles where like you're in a cipher, everyone's freestyling, and then
it's just
there's two dudes
it.
Who just won't, one of them just won't shut up. So they're just rapping over each other, and then they're like, yo, shut the fuck up. I'm like, and then it turns into a battle. Like, I love those battles.
I just never went far in the battling because it takes such a competitive like nature that eventually I never cared enough to take it all away, you know?
Yeah.
I've been in battles to where I made it to like the semifinals and then lost, you know? And
yeah. That shit, I do sometimes miss the over the beats battle, you know, where you sign up and you go up. It was just like different
Although,
energy.
Although, like, I do appreciate those. A lot of the battles now with no beat.
Yeah, no. I mean, it's a whole nother thing. They are far more intricate and incredible. Because I remember the over the beats battles, like the energy is like really cool because you go up and you just feel it, even if it's like some you rewatch and it's shitty as fuck.
Right.
At the moment, it was great. Yeah. You know, now it's become a whole nother thing. Yeah. Like it is a one man show.
Yeah. For real.
Like
I still feel torn about it because, to some extent, I miss like the you know the Rap Olympics kind of like style of battling.
Yeah.
You know where it is beats, but it's also more freestyling. It's leaning a little bit more in freestyle. Obviously, you have your lines ready. You know, Eminem.
Right.
If you go back.
Yeah, exactly.
He recycled lines all the time.
Yeah.
But he was ready.
At the time, though, you was like, oh, he's off the top.
Yeah. He didn't sound like anybody. So I was like, what is this?
Yeah, they're going to have to staple stitch you because you rip off your facial tissue, turn this into a racial issue. Yeah. Oh, my God, bro. Like, that was a crazy scheme right there.
Yeah, awesome.
Yeah, man, I just wanted to, you know, release my battling enthusiast talk with y'all real quick.
Yeah. Right.
So, like, what are y'all working on now? Like, y'all put out a project last year.
Uh-huh.
Wonderful.
Wonderful Ego Trip.
Ego Trip, we're talking about right now.
Uh-huh. And, which is kind of what we was,
And that was the whole vibe of it. Like, what are you guys working on now?
A couple secret projects that we can't.
Oh, so you're not, you know, in, okay.
Like it's things that.
The stuff we talked about earlier.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Working on stuff, cool stuff, being more creative, producing way more, working with different artists, different artists come up.
Been putting out singles, you know, for the summertime, just more so fun records. Because the last album was like more based around conception. You know, when you work on an album, you know, there's a whole little thing.
I mean,
just getting more to just dropping songs.
You guys usually like to do more conceptual thematic stuff with like a visual show that goes around it and stuff, right? Like, would you say that's like y'all thing?
Yeah.
It's an experience. It's some because you know a lot of times you hear that narrative nowadays because we had the internet and the streaming that the album isn't really like the thing anymore. People don't really buy into albums. It's a singles game. But so we're like, you know, an album is still a thing, you know, you just have to treat it as it's what album is, you know, like add a storyline to it, add like a cohesive project. So an idea, it's a whole experience.
Yeah.
You're not just getting one song. You're getting like one song that's attached to a greater idea.
I see that with like just catching y'all show in Seattle too, you know, just seeing like in the segues and stuff in between, like the things you say and like the messages you put in before you go into the songs.
Uh-huh.
It felt like an experience, you know what I'm saying? Man. And like, I think, I mean, if that's what you all are trying to do, I was inspired by that for
sure.
Thank you, man.
And it's tight. It's like when I get like an invitation to like something y'all do, it's always like, come experience this with us. I'm like, what am I getting myself into right here?
Open bar.
Take this peyote button.
Yeah, right. At the front of the door, it's like, yeah, welcome to the experience. Here's a peyote. That's amazing, man.
But we have a show on with DJ Jazzy Jeff.
It oh, sick. Fun. That's dope. He's still a fucking sick ass dude.
I've seen him once at the do-over, and he was crazy. I feel like I was too drunk to really, really remember.
He's a fun DJ.
I'm not going to drink
this. He wasn't there for the when you saw him at South by Southwest?
Nope.
Super faded. Nope. Where I was drinking like free Red Bull.
Nah, because we met y'all. Yeah, I remember that.
I had to sit down. I threw up.
I feel like we was with Laura. We was with Laura and
What's her name? From Sweden,
right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Oh, Nine Piece Laura.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, yeah. No, dude, Jazzy Jeff, just like the summer DJ. He's probably the king, bro.
Right. Shouts out to DJ Low Key. He's throwing like this event out there for like his 10-year anniversary. I want to say. And it's like with Red Bull, so it's like Fonte is gonna be out there, and Elliott.
Are y'all back in Los Angeles? Like both of y'all now? You guys been like always traveling or staying at a different city and shit, right? Right.
Just trying to pick up different vibes. Like we first kind of started doing it like when we went to Sweden and we met up with these producers, some comfort food, and it was just like, we was out there for what, like a week maybe? It was like, yo, we should do an album.
Yeah.
And everywhere we go, if we stay there for longer than a week, we should do an album.
That's sick. Yeah. That's sick. How was the Sweden experience like?
Crazy.
Awesome.
Crazy.
That's dope. Like, I can't even.
Food was kind of bland, but.
I'm not a big fan of the European food, man. Just, I'm not a fan of that.
It's weak. Get
your spices
I heard
up.
I heard France. I mean, if you get the ethnic, if you get the African food, you know,
that's what I'm saying. What I find interesting is even over there, it's like the immigrants of those countries put out the fire food, you know, like the Turkish, the doner kebabs.
Oh, yeah, right.
You know, like the first time I tried African food was actually in Germany, too. It was some African immigrants and they came through and they had the spices like. Very like there's a lot of spices, just hot sauces and all types of shit. I think I bought like a hot sauce for the rest of the European trip and shit.
What?
Like,
man, got to.
Fire. But it was dope though. It was dope over there. A lot of women, that's for sure.
And we went there like during like right around the time like before midsummer, what they call it. It's like a time of the year where like the sun is out like 20 hours of the day.
Man. Oh yeah.
That's lit.
Yeah, awesome. That's right.
I was like, yo, this is
2-3 in the morning, bright as hell outside.
If y'all could do a show anywhere in the world, where would it be? Like that you've never even gone before. I mean, or somewhere you might have gone before that you know, just like.
In the ionosphere. No.
Have you guys gone to Asia?
No.
I was about to say Japan, too. Japan. I've been to Japan before, but that's about it. Yeah.
No.
Japan is still amazing. I've only been there, you know, a couple days. But, man, there's not enough days to really check out the whole.
It might be cool to go to Rio.
We would love. Yeah, I would love to go to South America. Asia. Mm-hmm. Asian tour would be tight.
It'd be cool to go to South Africa for sure.
So you guys have performed
Nigeria
mainly in like Europe and US.
Yeah.
Okay, that's what's up.
Yeah,
that's crazy. Yeah. Like I just feel like there's so many regions I can see enjoying your music.
Right. Yeah, we're random. We randomly had like one of our biggest songs is because of Mexico. And Spain and Colombia, Madrid and shit like
that. Right, right.
Yeah, like love it.
That's dope.
So we need to go out there.
Yeah. Just gotta find that connect.
Yeah.
They need the experience globally.
Right.
The global experience.
You know, straight up.
Yo, I wanna thank y'all both for coming. You wanna plug anything else, you know, before we wrap up this episode?
Go get everything we've ever made.
Yeah. Like log on Google. Type in Tiron and Aomari. That's TironAyomari.
By the way, we got these shirts.
Imperfect or I'm perfect, depending on how you see it.
Right.
Now, for real, I encourage all of my listeners, all of my viewers to check out their music. I'm definitely a fan, and like just what they do with songs is like some other shit, you know? So I get inspired when I make my stuff too with artists like this and other artists I bring on, you know what I'm saying? Like that's one of the reasons I just want to put heads on to
y'all. Yeah, no doubt, man. That's why this shit is good, dog.
This shit is dope.
At some point in my career too, I made it a mission to share like dopeness too.
Right. You know what I mean?
And that's what this is. Right. So, yo, tune in next week. Fun with Dumb. Taron and Amari.
Whoop. Peace. Whoop.